Good morning, everyone. My name is Ilfak Guilfanov, and I will be speaking about IDA Pro and digital security. This is a short presentation outline. I'll talk about myself first. As we all know, digital security is more important than ever. This is why all of us gathered here today. We'll talk about the evolution of development tools. Then I will tell you a bit about IDA. And since the current situation is far from perfect, I will talk a bit about what we could do to improve the current situation. And at the end, questions and answers. I started my programming career more than 27 years ago. That was a professional career, but my experience with computers is more than 30 years already. I was studying mathematics at the Moscow University, and I was very lucky that when I started my studies, a kind of experimental course on programming was introduced. And in that course, we were talking not about programming languages. In other universities, people were studying Fortran, assembler, but we were not. We were studying some programming abstractions like vectors, stacks, lists. I was very lucky because this is the core of programming. It's not about programming languages. A language is a very important tool, but just a tool to express your thoughts. And that was a very interesting experience. After a couple of months, we were assigned some practical tasks to do something with computers, and that was only then I saw my first computer in my life, and I fell in love. It was amazing because computers were much slower than today, much less powerful, but not less interesting. And since then, I was always trying to write better code, and that's why I became a software developer. And today's talk, it will be from the point of view of a software developer. I am not a reverse engineer. I know that in many conferences, many presentations are about vulnerabilities, that someone found this or that vulnerability. I am on the other side of the barricade, we can say so. I am the one that creates vulnerabilities. All zero-day vulnerabilities are created, after all, by software developers. And you can blame us that we are not doing our job well enough. But the truth is that the task is extremely difficult. This is why we still continue to create vulnerabilities and bugs and so on. But I believe that we should strive to improve our coding practices. We should try to make our lives better by writing more efficient and more robust software. And I'm the author of IDA Pro and the decompiler. And the talk is, we'll talk about a lot about IDA in our talk. And I'm the founder and the CEO of Hex-Ray. Well, CEO is just a word because I still love programming and I still love to develop software. Well, you all know that digital security is more important than ever. if we talk about how was the situation 25 years ago, there was no connectivity. I remember that the first time I saw the word network, I'm not a native English speaker, and network was something, an unknown word for me. I could not decipher its meaning because I was not aware of networking. It was not really existing at that time. 10 years ago, we were already connected, but not as much as today. Our computers would be connected using dial-up lines, but now, today, all our computers, and not only big desktop computers, but other stuff like smartphones, NAS, storages, devices, everything is connected 24 hours. This is why we are powerful. That makes this makes them powerful, but at the same time, it makes them vulnerable at the same time. And again, if you talk about how was the situation 25 years ago, there was no information, much information on our computers. Personal computers were just entering our homes, and we mostly were keeping only text files. Then we started to keep photos, videos, and now much more personal and sensitive information is stored there, like medical records, bank account information, and so on and so on and so on. That's why the digital security is more important than ever. As we all know that the current situation is far from perfect because most of our software has vulnerability holes. And when software has a vulnerability hole, the end user usually cannot do much about it. Because sometimes he can just turn off a service, but most of the time, either he cannot do anything, or what is even worse, he is not aware of the problem. And these problems are due to design flaws. I remember that 25 years ago, we were happy that it just works. We were not caring about the security. The word really was not applying to computers at that time. So the software is designed just to work. Second thing is that even if the design was good enough, there were some buggy implementations because we are human beings and we make mistakes. We maybe introduce bugs. Then the notion of testing, it was not that widespread. Software is tested much less than today. And over the time, all of this changed. And now the requirements are much higher, but unfortunately, our software developing procedures and attitudes are still the same. And because of that, we'll hear more security-related problems like stolen credit cards, disclose sensitive information. In fact, I wrote these slides 2 months ago, and now everyone knows about the story with Sony Pictures, and unfortunately, there maybe will be more stories like that. Is everything lost? No, I don't think so. I think that the situation is improving over time. In fact, our software improves. Most our new systems are developed with the security in mind, and our society better handles digital security-related issues. It's just that our requirements are much higher than before. If we compare how the situation was in the past and today, the difference is enormous. First of all, our development methods are constantly improving. Compilers become better over time. I remember the very first compilers would not even issue any warnings, not even talk about static analysis or anything like that. We have more compilers. They are more robust than before. The programming languages themselves, they become better. And for example, C++ had no templates initially, and now there are templates. We have more languages, Python, C Sharp, and so on and so on. We have better programming paradigms. I remember that when we were studying this programming course, we were not talking about security at all. We were talking about making things work, and that's all. And later, different paradigms like defensive programming, different design patterns appeared, and hopefully we will use them more and more often. We have better software revision systems. Before, it was not existing either. And agile programming, pair programming. If you are into software development, and you must know all these, I would say buzzwords, but they are very, very useful buzzwords. Another aspect is that now we are talking about analyzing our software and testing it much more seriously than before. 25 years ago, there was just an utility called lint. It was issuing some warnings about your code, saying that this construct is not that good, or that one looks suspicious. And by the way, this utility still exists. It exists, but unfortunately, it's quite limited. And now we have testing frameworks, more powerful debuggers, fuzzers, let's say memory analyzers. For example, we have Valgrind and many, many other things. And because of that, because our development tools were not adequate, it was very, very hard to develop software 20 years ago. I took this table from Wikipedia, and you see that in 93, the whole operating system, Windows, was only 4 to 5 million lines of code. But I think that it was a big team of programmers working on that number of lines. My table ends at 2003. You see that at 2003, already they had 50 million lines of code. And I'm sure that more than 10 years later, we have the size of the Windows operating system maybe got multiplied by 10. I just don't know. And all this is because software development tools allow us to develop much better than before. Another reason was that computers were slower. You could not really fuzz or test all combinations. Even today, it's not possible. But the difference is still enormous. There was no memory protection to isolate different applications from each other. So if an application misbehaved, it would take down the whole operating system with itself. So let us take a small tour, and I will start with the utility that every programmer needs. It's the editor called ed. This is an editor that does not display the whole text on the screen. Maximum, it can display one line at a time. Yet it was very considered very powerful tool at that time because it has regular expressions, and it was even programmable. And because of that, even today, many Unix distributions still included and still can be used. Naturally, nobody will use such an editor anymore. When I started to program, I started with VI. It was already a big improvement over Ed, but still it was inadequate for programming. You can imagine that using such an editor, you cannot go very far. Compilers were not producing warnings or very little. Some of them could even produce buggy code. I remember that I think that I stopped having special workarounds for compilers maybe 10 years ago or even less. No, even today we have some kind of workarounds because some of them can still produce buggy code. But before it was really, really bad. The code optimization was not good and the computers were slow. So we were always thinking about how to improve the situation, but by manually optimizing our code. Despite all these things, I still consider compilers as compiler writers as semi-gods because they do something amazing. And then Turbo C compilers from Borland arrived. As the name implies, they were much faster than others. The name Turbo means fast. The same company Borland, they also gave us the Turbo debugger. It has a very nice user interface. It was powerful, robust, can display the source code. Today, you take all this stuff for granted. You say, we have all of this stuff. But before, in the past, it was not the case. I was using Turbo Debugger most of the time because I'm a software developer. But many others were using SoftEyes. It's a system-level debugger. It was very powerful, and because of its popularity, it can be considered as a disadvantage because some programs were using anti-debugging tricks, anti-SoftEyes tricks, just to prevent from being debugged, so they cannot be debugged. As a software developer or just as a computer person, we will using debuggers very often. First of all, to find bugs, but second, to gather some knowledge, to collect some knowledge. It's always like that. It's impossible to find documentation for everything. There are always some undocumented things with computers, some obscure hardware device, a driver, or a specific algorithm, or even a virus. Viruses were already existing 25 years ago, but they were primitive compared to today's viruses and much less harmful. At the beginning, debuggers were enough to analyze them, but as the viruses grow, programs as they grow, debuggers were not enough. And at that time, we needed something more powerful. A disassembler. A disassembler is the tool that takes a binary file and converts into an assembly listing. A very simple disassembler can be written, let's say, within a few days. The only thing that if you want to make a disassembler really powerful, you have to implement some algorithms to analyze the program, to maintain the cross-references, to assign meaningful names to addresses and data, and so on, and so on, and so on. And surprisingly enough, such a program at that time existed. It was called Sourcer. It was a really great tool. For a newcomer, it was like magic. It would tell apart code from data. That's surprising because this problem in general cannot be solved. It's unsolvable in general case. This assembler would also assign meaningful names and it would add comments to the listing. And it was multi-pass. It was making multiple passes over this binary file, finding more and more information and in order to produce nice, meaningful listing. And this multi-pass feature, it was its disadvantage because it was taking time. It was usually I had to run the disassembler and sit down and wait until it stops. And with a big program, it could take even, hours or even days. And what is even worse, that sometimes it could misidentify code or data. And then if something went wrong, you have to restart from scratch. And this is very, very annoying. To answer this question, what to do, how to overcome this problem, the answer was interactivity. To make the disassembler an interactive program, so the user presses a key, and the disassembler immediately modifies the program representation and shows nicely everything on the screen. The idea itself is not something new, and there was such a disassembler called disdoc. I haven't used it myself, so I cannot tell you much, but the idea is great. No need to wait for the results. Again, we take this for granted today, but it was not like this before. The user can browse the listing, annotate it. The user can tell where is the code, where is the data. And at that time, there was something, another buzzword called WYSIWYG. What you see is what you get. And this is something new. You remember red, Ed? It was not WYSIWYG at all. So this was the reason why I decided to create IDA, because it is something that is interactive, and there was a need in the disassemblers to analyze viruses, to analyze other stuff. But it was quite difficult to get everything right at the first time. I think that very rarely it happens that someone implements a system, a program, whatever, and gets everything right from the first time. It's just never happens, I think. I had to rewrite many times the code. My initial tries were either too big, too slow, or too lightweight, and therefore limited. You remember that at that time we had only 640 kilobytes and nothing else. And I needed a robust and fast database to store the results. I played with different database engines. I tried Paradox, I tried others. None of them were working well. They were either too slow, either they were taking too much resources, too much memory. So I was stuck. But fortunately, my friend Pavel Rusnak implemented a B-tree engine. B-tree is a data structure used by database engines. It's something internal to databases. Usually, it is not available as an engine by itself. So it is hidden inside the database engine. And we decided to use, I decided to use B-tree engine as is. There were some shortcomings. One of the biggest shortcomings is that if you use B-tree as is, unprotected, and you have a power outage, you will lose the data. IDA still has, we added some workarounds to fix the problem, but overall, it was working quite well, and that's why I decided to use this database engine, and this is the engine we still use in IDA. It took me 6 months to implement the first version, 0.1. It looks ugly, especially from today's standards, but it was working. And it was interactive. And I immediately started to get positive feedback from the users. They were saying, oh, that's great, because it works, and this is something that we need. And that was the main reason why I decided, okay, this is something interesting. I will continue to work on it. Even if as a hobby, it was a side project. I liked to implement the stuff, but it was not something commercial yet. I was just doing it for my fun. And I was much younger at the time, and young people tend to innovate much better than others. The next version, 2.09, appeared in 94. You see that it took 3 years to implement something new. The engine inside the disassembler was the same as before, but the user interface was much better. It was using TurboVision library from Borland, and it was quite a big program for that time. It was already 500 kilobytes. 500 kilobytes, you cannot fit that much code into a PC memory. You remember you had only 640, and you have to give almost 100 to the operating system, then you end up with 40 kilobytes for data. You remember that it's 400 kilobytes for code. So it cannot fit the memory. And because of that, it was overlaid. It was, we were loading one part of the program to the memory, executing it, then loading another part of the program to the same place, executing something else. It was slowing things down, but making it possible to work at least. And because of that, I was saving every byte. All strings were stored on the disk, and every time a string needs to be displayed, it was read from the disk. It was slow, but it was working. Then the next version was 3.5. It was released in the 96. It already had loadable modules, different processors. By the way, again, when I say the loadable model, you say you think about DLL, dynamically loadable library. But at that time, MS-DOS did not support them. Compilers were not supporting them, so I had to implement everything myself. I had to implement something that mimics, implements these loadable models. Well, anyway, there were many other releases. I don't mention them now because not to bore you. Initially, I had very ambitious plans for IDA. My first and foremost desire was to implement some kind of artificial intelligence with a Lisp-like language. So IDA would analyze programs and tell the user what can be improved in the binary. Even today, I did not implement all this, the list. Second point is building a binary program optimizer using either for binary translation. So you take a binary, file for one processor, IDA takes it and converts into a binary for another processor. Yeah, the plans were ambitious, but they were not implemented because of the users. I don't blame the users because They are the driving force after for IDA, because they have positive feedback that makes it that makes me tick, that makes me implement new things. But all these plans were not implemented, and maybe someone else later in the future will implement them. In 1996. I was very lucky to encounter Mr. Pierre van de Ven from Belgium. He got interested in IDA, and his contribution cannot be overestimated, because with him, we converted my hobby project into a commercial product. One of the first things he convinced me to do is to create a graphical version of IDA. I was saying, no, I worked with punch cards, and the text version is good enough. No need in anything else, because if you compare punch cards and text mode is great. But the new generation of users, they prefer to use a graphical user interface, and it seems that a new generation will need something even better than three-dimensional graphical user interface, whatever. It always pays off to have a nice user interface. By the way, Pierre found the lady we use for IDA logo. It's Madame de Maintenon. the lover of the second wife or the lover of the French king, Louis XIV, Louis XIV. With Data Rescue is the company that was commercializing IDA. I was not working on IDA alone anymore because it was turned into commercial product. We had more people. I just want to mention two more names. It's Eric Landuit and Laurent Sansonetti. They were young guys that improved IDA a lot as well. We improved IDA a lot. We added the graphical user interface. We added a debugger. Initially, it was just a disassembler. We added navigation band. Our user base grew over time. We were always growing. And we released many, many new versions of IDA. And at that time, we were even got noticed by PC Magazine, and we were nominated as a finalist of the technical award for excellence. We lost. It happens. We lost to Microsoft with their .NET Studio, Visual Studio. But it was still fun. At that time, one of our biggest problems was piracy. We were receiving maybe more messages from pirates than from legitimate users. Now it's different. Now we don't care. But at that time, we were caring, and we were trying to help everyone. But pirates, they were just eating our time and resources. A typical conversation with them would start with a compliment from them saying, "Oh, what a wonderful program you have." That was the first message. The second message was, "Oh, I need a small help from you, a little help." And the third message, if it arrived, it was very often rude, and so it was predictable. We got used to it. Frankly, I don't really understand when clever people use pirated software, and especially when they go and ask for help. Maybe they are not that clever after all. Yeah, the piracy was quite a big problem in 2006. For example, this is a map of all the locations we received on our server. We programmed IDA to request to check for a new version at that time, and we were receiving many requests on our server like this. And there was some. Sometimes it's not only piracy. Sometimes it was, for example, a student who was saying, "I am a poor student, but I want the most expensive version of the software right away because I have a very important client." Or we had someone, a pastor, who wanted the copy for free, but promised to pray for us in return. Well, IDA itself was a good thing, but it was just producing a disassembly listing, and to use it, you need to be a specialist to be able to read assembler code, to modify it, to know a little bit how compilers work. And the idea was to improve the situation by writing a decompiler on top of IDA that would generate a C-like code. I was greatly inspired by Cristina Cifuentes. She wrote a PhD thesis on decompilation. After reading it, it was clear how to write a decompiler, but there were many, many problems still unsolved. So I had to come up with an idea or algorithm how to solve a problem, implement it, test it, And then if it doesn't work, then throw it away and start over. Wash, rinse, repeat. But I like this. That's why I was persistent. I was continuing to do this for years and years and years. I think that I started to write some code in 1998, but it was not really robust or working. So it took really long time to implement something really working. And the first version was implemented, published in 2007. The problem of decompilation is a huge problem with many, many unsolvable in general problems, sub-problems. And because of that, it's very time-consuming to develop, especially for one person. So the thing is to find what corners to cut. You cannot implement everything. Even today, for example, in the decompiler, we have many things that are just not implemented, let's say, completely properly, correctly. There are some stuff that is, okay, it's not that great. It can be improved. But without cutting corners, it's just impossible to implement any decompiler. Unfortunately, Pierre decided to quit in 2007, so I had to continue alone. We are still in France. It was maybe pirates. It was maybe other reasons. But I had to continue alone. I founded Hex-Rays, and Hex-Rays quickly became a strong and passionate team about that we do care about our code. We try to publish as bug-free as software as possible, and we do care about our users. I think that this is the main reasons why our software is the most popular. I was not only me on now, but we were maintaining IDA all these years because IDA is a useful tool, and our users are really nice and bright people in general. Of course, IDA can be used for good and bad as any tool, as any other tool, like cracking software, stealing code and algorithms, but I tend to believe that it's mostly used for good. At least our users, they look like white hats. I myself perceive IDA as a seeing aid, like a microscope. It is a very necessary tool. It's indispensable to professionals, but it requires some skills to use. And if I talk about using IDA, the very frequent question is, who uses IDA after all? It's a very motley crew. The various people use IDA. We can mention antivirus company, security-oriented organizations, governments, military, various hobbyists, and then shady persons of all kinds, pirates, and all that stuff. So we have to be quite careful with our users. While most of them are nice, some of them are not that nice. For example, quite often we got blackmailed. Like Sony Pictures got blackmailed because the bad people got their secrets. We get blackmailed when someone leaks our software and says, okay, I got you, I have your software, I will leak it on the internet. Our usual answer is, go what you wish. Go do what you wish, I'm sorry. I wanted to make a slide with the distribution of IDA users over the world, and I even made a map with saying that here in this country we have IDA users, in this country we have IDA users, but I ended up with the whole globe painted green with the exception of Central Africa and a few other countries, so I decided not to show it. Overall, we have users everywhere. And how either improves our security? I tend to believe that our legitimate users are white hats, and while we are not in the spotlight ourselves, our users are quite often famous security researchers, and you hear from them that they found this or that vulnerability problem, or they disclose some information about them, and because of that, vulnerabilities get fixed. We are glad that we can help them with this important task, and we want either to be safe for them, that's why we also improve security of either. So on one hand, either helps to secure other things, and on the other hand, we try to improve security of either so it is safer to use either for our users. I think that we still have a very long way to go, but we do a lot of stuff like we run tests, we compile our code with various compilers. I'm looking at this list of different measures we take to make either better, but I still have an impression that it is not enough. We need to do more than before. By the way, our user reports, if either user finds some problem with either, he sends us a message, and this message arrives at our developers. We don't have any first, second line help lines, and developers are the ones who suffer from their bugs if they make them. We try to improve our coding style. We keep adding more test cases, and so on. I think that the last couple of years we were really focusing on improving our test cases a lot. But our resources, as any other company's resources, are limited, and we cannot test all configurations. This is the reason why we run our own bug bounty program. The idea is very simple. If you find a bug in either, we'll pay you a bounty. I'm glad that many other companies follow the trend, and they do the same thing, and the bug bounty programs become more and more widespread. Naturally, a bug bounty program is not a silver bullet, and it will not solve all our problems, but it is still a good idea because it helps to find new bugs in the software. I think that we released more than 20 different vulnerabilities. We fixed them and we published the fixes. We try to be fast. I think that software developers should take these vulnerabilities as seriously as possible and just maybe switch the tasks. If you don't have enough software developers to fix vulnerability bugs, well, then let them fix bugs first and then only then return to their normal routine work. I know that the usual turning around time is counted by months, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, but software vendors should try to be faster than that. We are a small company and our testing cases are not that big, of course, compared to others, but we try to be to publish a fix within 5-7 days, if possible. We understand that it's not possible for bigger companies, for example, with millions lines of code and so on. By the way, we have 1.5 million lines of code in IDES, I think, now. And sometimes we even pay the bounties for memory corruption bugs, even if there is no proof of concept code. Because if it's memory corruption, maybe it can be exploitable, so we cannot exclude this. We better fix it, and we better thank the researchers who found the bug. I think that this is the correct attitude towards vulnerability bugs. Otherwise, it's just waiting for something bad happened. Okay, it happens not to us, it happens to our users. But in the long run, I think that not caring about your users will affect the bottom line. I wrote these slides 2 months ago, and I added something like, we have to add a fuzzer to our test methods. But in fact, we did already. Because of the recent developments, but either should be improved more, we have to add more tests, we have to add more tests for Python, and so on, so on. And while I'm talking about either, I think that it's not only about either. It's about, it's about other software as well. It should be, we should raise our standards, how we develop software. Since security becomes more important than ever, we have to change our attitude as well. There are some companies, like Microsoft, already got the message, but there are many others, small companies, that think that they can get by without doing that. But I think that they're wrong in the long run. Nothing prevents, in theory, but getting blackmailed even for a small company. We know it on our, because we got that experience. So maybe my a few of my last slides, they look a bit desperate because I mentioned that we have to test, we have to improve, we have to. Why it's so? Why is it so? Why is it so hard to get everything right? In my opinion, it's so hard because we are kind of blind. Let me give you this analogy. We are trying to make a watertight ways, pot, whatever, and but we are blind, so we don't see where are there any holes or not. So we have to palpate it with our fingers and to see if there are any holes. And unfortunately, we miss them, and the liquid will leak out. So this is the same with security. As humans, we are not capable to foresee all the consequences of our algorithms. So we need some external help, we need some tools, and I think that computers can help us here. So we have to automate testing. I wouldn't say goes that far that to say to automate programming. I remember that 15 years ago it was quite in the fashion. The people were talking about fourth generation languages, saying that computers would write the programs themselves and they execute them themselves. Unfortunately, it didn't work that well because we still have to program computers ourselves. Maybe it will happen, but I don't think that it will happen right now. But computers can help us with other routine tasks, like testing our software, monitoring that they use. They can be used to prove its correctness. They can be used as tools, like IDE itself. And eventually, maybe computers will develop software, but I don't think that it will happen in the nearest future. The things I am talking here, I think that they apply to all companies, all software development companies, not only to us, that if you want our digital environment to be safer, we have to take these points seriously and to implement, to test our software. Unfortunately, it's impossible to test all possible cases. There are just too many of them. But it's not an excuse to say, okay, we don't test anything. So we have to test. Testing must be continuous, so we continue, we have dedicated computers that would test our software. And I think that these steps must be done for all, by all companies, big or small, it doesn't matter. We have to think as an attacker, as a malicious person who wants to attack our software. And so we have to attack it ourselves. We have to find, try to find the possible vulnerability holes in it. And each time we find a new bug, we fix it, we add a new test case. And as many others say, write a test case before fixing the bug. Testing itself is not enough because we cannot test all possible scenarios. That's why we have to monitor our software, how it is used. Sometimes the environments change and the software that was not vulnerable today becomes vulnerable tomorrow because something in the configuration changes. Sometimes it was vulnerable, but sometimes researchers discover new threats, and in this case, we have to fix our software. Therefore, we have to monitor our systems. There are many solutions exist. The best solution, in my opinion, is some kind of custom in-house made solution, but unfortunately, I understand that it's not affordable for everyone. So, but at least we have to use some ready-to-use solutions, at least. Nowadays, there are some software verification tools. They slowly become mature, and we should consider using them. We should consider switching from old languages like C++ to better languages. C++, it's a great language. It's one of the most powerful languages, but it has many shortcomings that will stay with it for years. So maybe it's better to use other programming languages. Sometimes we can use code generators and tools to avoid stupid human mistakes with our code. These tools are not completely mature yet, but we should be looking at this proving our software. And that's all. Thank you for your attention. Do you have any questions?